I thought this was supposed to be a young people's church. Hey, just in case you were wondering, because if I ask you to name them, except for this man right here, most of you would probably name the big wars. You wonder how many American servicemen and women have died in the line of duty? And that's what Memorial Day is. Don't confuse Veterans Day with Memorial Day. Veterans Day is in November when we just honor all of our veterans. Memorial Day is specifically to honor those that have died in service to their country. And, of course, we remember their families as well. Only 4,435 lost their lives in service to their country during the American Revolution. Only problem was that was a significant portion of the population at the time. In the War of 1812, 2,260. During the Indian Wars, and we're not going to get into a lot of political correctness here, but there were Indian Wars out in the plains. 1,000 men and women lost their lives. The Mexican War, 13,283. The Civil War, to preserve the Union, 498,332. That is still the deadliest war in our history. The Spanish-American War, 2,446. The World War I, you know, the war that ended all wars, 116,516. It didn't, because then came World War II, where we lost 405,399 men and women. The deadliest battle of that war was in the forest of Bastogne. Am I correct about that? You know how many were killed there? Around 26 or 27,000, I think, in that one battle. The Korean War, 54,246. The Vietnam War, 90,220. The Persian Gulf War, the first one after 9/11, 1,565. And then something that we don't mind putting a name on here, the Global War on Terror, 6,852. That brings the total to 1,100,000, 1.1 million men and women. That's rounded up a little bit. 1,100,000 men and women in the history of our nation who have given their lives in service to their country. That's who we honor this weekend. That's who, when you're sitting in front of the grill tomorrow getting your hamburgers ready, that you take some moments to think about. It's still happening, all right? Let's get into 1 Peter. This is another one of those lessons that you're not going to like and you're going to be asking toward the end of it. You've got to be kidding. But there are things that the Bible says that we can't get around. We cannot ignore it because it is God's Word, but it so flies in the face of what our nature is. And so we're in 1 Peter chapter 2, verses 11 through 25. I call this a mirror image because of who we're supposed to look like. I don't know how often you look in the mirror. I'm not really a mirror-gazing person. I have to do it to shave because I want to make sure I get this goatee just right and I don't want to make any mistakes. And I can't make a mistake on this mustache because my wife, this is our 40th anniversary year this year. Next month, we'll be married 40 years. He's been with us 35 next month. But she's never seen me without a mustache. So I have to be careful about that. But I do occasionally look, and the other day I had this something on my nose. I thought about calling Michaela to see if she could help me. I couldn't figure out what it was. All I knew is there was this red spot, and it was like the bull's eye of a target on my nose. I'm 62 years old. And I thought, I want to go out in public and have people see this big red dot coming at them before they ever see my face. And then I pulled this makeup mirror that Vicki has right beside our vanity. You know, it's got one of those that just looks normal. And then you flip it around, and you see the pores. And I thought, my stars, that's some kind of hole. And apparently I had scratched my nose with an extra long fingernail and just kind of dug a chunk out of it. So I was able to get a little, I don't know what that was that Vicki gave me to put on it. There was powder and there was cream. And there was shining like buffing a shoe. Anyway, it worked pretty well. You know what I hated about that magnification mirror? You could see every pore, every hair, every flaw. And I thought, man, it's much easier to look, step back about 6 feet from this mirror at the vanity and just look and say, well, that looks all right. Yeah. What we're supposed to do as followers of Jesus Christ is we're supposed to step back and take a look at Jesus and say, how's this reflection look? How am I reflecting you? Okay. Now, let me tell you a story. Many, many years ago, before the advent of cable and satellite TV, y'all will not remember that, there was a time when you needed an antenna on your roof to improve the reception for the three channels that may be available to you. Some people used rabbit ears, but they would quickly realize that unless they just lived right in the city where the broadcast was coming from, it was better to have a rooftop antenna. And sometimes you could get them with the rotors that were mechanical, so you had this little machine that sat on top of the TV and you pressed a button and it would make the thing go around and around and around till your reception was perfect, and then you stopped it. Okay? Huh? You turned yours manually? You sent somebody up on the roof to turn it? Okay. Yeah. I had some experience with this, okay, because when I was in between college experiences and needed a job, I'd worked for some time at a dairy, but until I got that dairy job, I'd gotten a job with a guy in the church putting up TV antennas. That was the one time that I was on a roof and I had a nice little wad of tobacco in my mouth, and that time they didn't have these convenient little packets. We still used the plugs that you could buy that looked like a deck of cards, and they were sealed, and you just cut off a piece and put it in there. And that was the only time that I've ever fallen off a roof, and I landed flat on my back, thank God. But the only thing about it was I could not find the chaw. But I could feel it. And I thought, never again. Anyway, so when I get to seminary, I'm needing a part-time job. And so I look in the little newspaper in the little town that we live in, Wake Forest, and I see this ad for a guy that owns a TV shop, and he's looking for part-time help installing TV antennas. So I went and got the job because I had experience. Sitting one day in a recreation room that we had at the seminary, pool tables, that kind of thing, we're just sitting there, and one of my seminary classmates asked me about the job, and I told him just enough to satisfy his curiosity, but when he found out what I was doing, I think he was trying out a sermon illustration on me, because he said, let me tell you a story. And he told me this story about a guy who wanted to install his own antenna without any help on his two-story home. So he climbs the ladder, and he pulls the box up, and he sits down on the roof, because you have to assemble this thing before you can put it up. And it was tall and it was heavy, but he managed to get the antenna up anyway, and he had the guy wires attached to it. And see, that's the thing. When you think installation is complete, it's not, because just because you get it nailed in, screwed in, and right there on the peak of your roof, you got the guy wires attached to the antenna, and you need to attach those guy wires at a pretty good tension to the corners of the roof so that it holds this thing steady in wind. And so he grabs the end of one guy wire and he begins to creep his way down toward one of the corners when his feet just kind of slide out from under him, and all of a sudden he is sliding like mud towards the edge of the roof. And he goes right on off, and he grabs at everything he can and finally gets a hold of the gutter. So he's hanging there on the gutter, and he sees that this thing is not real stable, and so he's thinking, what am I going to do? And finally, when he didn't have anything else in mind, there was no answers coming, he started to cry out, and he said, help me, God, help me. And surprisingly, there's this voice that seems to come from heaven. I mean, it's a resounding voice and says, I will help you. And that's all it said. So the guy is sweating now, and he's really beginning to swing a little bit, and his hand's getting slippery, and he says, Lord, what do you want me to do? And the voice from heaven says, just let go, and I will catch you and set you down on the ground. And the guy thinks for a few seconds and then yells, is there anybody else up there with a better idea? Now, some of you are going to be saying that at the end of this teaching. You're going to sit here and you're going to read it in the Scriptures, because I hope you open your Bibles to look at this while we're talking about it. And you're going to hear some things, and you, at the end of it, you're going to say, are you kidding? Is there a better idea than what you're presenting? And the answer to that question is no. Sometimes as followers of Jesus, and for the sake of definition, I'm just going to call us disciples. Okay? I'm just going to call us disciples from this point in the message. We get into trouble often. Stresses and pressures come into our lives, and we begin to feel burdened. Sometimes the burden is so heavy that, like Job in Job chapter 10, verses 1 and 2, he just shouts out, I'm disgusted with my life, and I've got some things that I want to say to God. I'm going to complain bitterly. Now, the truth is, sometimes these burdens we bring on ourselves with poor decision-making, or when we just yield to worldly or fleshly desires, you know, temptation to sin, you understand that. But sometimes the burdens come from unfair treatment by others. Now, you have to understand that it's a part of humanity and living in a fallen state. Since Adam and Eve... The hedge around us has been removed. And every human being, Christian or not, disciple or not, doesn't matter what culture, what age, everyone faces challenges and disappointments and hardships in life. And when it happens in abundance, particularly if it seems unfair, whether we think God's being unfair or whether somebody else has been unfair to us, it can bring a real weariness to the soul. That's what was happening with Job. He had gone through so much in such a short time that he's thinking, I hate my life and I just wish it was over. At least two times in the book of Job, he said, I wish I had never been born. So what are we supposed to do as disciples of the Lord Jesus when we don't get that raise or promotion that we were expecting? How are we supposed to act when that relationship doesn't work out, or someone we love is taken from us, in an accident or by some disease or even a criminal act. How should we respond when we are criticized and belittled and shunned or even faulted and assaulted because we followed Jesus? You know, sometimes assaults can be verbal. Sometimes they can be passive. Like the student who tries to follow Jesus in school and they're really adamant about being faithful followers and other kids begin to shun them because somebody says, you need to stay away from that one, that one's a Christian. You know, that's a passive assault. How are we supposed to act? First of all, I have to offer you three ways not to act. They are natural reactions to mistreatment. Natural. We are not supposed to live according to what is natural because we as disciples have the Holy Spirit living in us. This is the third person of the Godhead, the Trinity. He lives in us. He represents the Lord Jesus in us. Colossians chapter 1, verse 27, you'll need to write this one down because I don't have it on your sheet. Colossians 1, 27, Paul writes that the mystery about us among unbelievers, he calls them Gentiles there, but what he's talking about is unbelievers. The mystery about us among believers is Christ in you, the hope of glory. They see Jesus in you. So we are supposed to act or react, however you want to put it, from a spiritual realm and not the flesh. We are supposed to react as if the Lord Jesus Christ through His Spirit is controlling us rather than we taking action on our own. But far too often, we don't do that. We fall into the pit of reacting no differently from those who claim no knowledge of God and no love for God. We just react like the rest of the world does. Okay? Here are three natural reactions to being mistreated. The first is the blame game. Now, I'm not trying to get political here, but we can bring up that we have heard that in the news media just within the last two or three days as, commencement speeches were given by certain politicians. You know, sometimes when things happen, it's done. You just have to be a grown-up and pull up your panties and just go ahead with your life instead of blaming. It's not my fault, it's your fault. It's not my fault, it's their fault. It's not my fault. You know, there are people out there who just always look to blame and never accept responsibility. This is a model of absolute self-centeredness. This is a model of a person who cares only for themselves. It involves self-pity. It involves grumbling. It involves whining. It involves complaining to anyone listening. Anyone who will give them a sympathetic ear. And let me tell you something. When somebody falls into this kind of reaction and you offer that sympathetic ear for very long, you often will find yourself inundated with information about the latest wrong that they feel like they've suffered and a list of those who are responsible. You know, that's the kind of person you have to block on Facebook because you get tired of hearing it. But let me tell you something. That kind of response to mistreatment and wrongdoing suffered is like quicksand, and the longer you stay in it, the more likely it will suck you down into the darkness of depression and isolation. And the isolation you'll bring on yourself because people will isolate you because they don't want to hear it. Now, let me say something I've never said to you before. Can I get an amen? You ever heard it? You ever been it? Well, I'm here to tell you that's a natural reaction. That has nothing to do with the Spirit of God. That has nothing to do with the Lord Jesus. It has everything to do with the selfish spirit. The second thing is the lame game. Look, I'm not going to give you a biblical basis for these because this is mine. Okay? It's not God. I'm just trying to explain some things to you that I believe God gave me. But, you know, don't. If you want to search the scriptures and add Bible to it, please feel like you can do that. I can tell you this. In the Old Testament, God hated grumbling. He brought judgment on the Israelites in the Old Testament more than once because they whined and grumbled. So I'd be careful about that. The lame game. What is the lame game? What did I do? I just reversed these. I'm sorry. The first one is the blame game, and I went on and talked to you about the lame game, didn't I? The lame game is the self-pity and the grumbling and the whining. So go back to blame, or put that as number two. You know what the blame game is? The lame game is the self-pity. The blame game, this is why it's so dangerous. When we have a tendency to blame, boy, I messed that up really bad, didn't I? I better start using 16 font. Listen, I'm not going to go through all that lame game again. You get the picture. You understand the self-pity and the self-centeredness and the whining and the grumbling. The blame game, here's the only thing I'll say about the blame game that I was talking about with the politicians, why it's so dangerous. The reason the blame game is so dangerous when we want to blame somebody else for everything that goes wrong in our lives is because it can become aggressive. And the thing is, it can be physically aggressive or it can be passively aggressive. I have actually known of church conflicts that degenerated to the point of physical aggression where police had to be called to break it up. Because people wanted their own way. Or they felt like they were being mistreated and they weren't going to stand for it. So they have this brother or sister in Christ who disagrees with them and they want to take it outside. I know there's a couple of people that I wish they'd have said that to me and I would have probably gone out with them gladly just to see what kind of sin stain I could rub off of them. Anyway, here's what happens with the blame game. First of all, there's no forgiveness. There's no option for forgiveness. Secondly, they will keep a record of the wrongs that they think they've suffered. You know, in 1 Corinthians chapter 13, one of the things it says about real love is that love does not keep an account of wrongs suffered. It's kind of like God who says, I will cast your sins behind my back and remember them no more. Isn't that great? So he's encouraging us to love like he does. But the person who's involved in the blame game will not do that. They will remember everything you've ever done. So wives, when your husbands say, you remember what you did back in 1997? That's the time for you to say no, and neither should you. You know, whether I ask forgiveness or not, you're my husband and you shouldn't be remembering that. Because that's not what disciples do. And then what happens with the person that is involved in the blame game is they begin to develop this victim mentality. It's because I'm a woman. It's because I'm of a different culture. Black, Hispanic, you name it. It's because, you know, rather than saying, I'm a human being made in the image of God and I'm going to stand up and I'm going to be a child of God no matter what anybody else does to me, you develop this victim mentality. And here's the real long-term danger. It will engender resentment. It will engender bitterness. And it will even engender revenge. Had this guy that he was forced to resign from his church, kind of like our brother Kevin. You know, sometimes in situations in churches, you know, churches and pastors, there's some conflict. Excuse me. Rather than resolving it biblically and showing love and respect to one another, it can get quite emotional. And you know, when we start reacting emotionally rather than reasonably and according to the principles of God's Word, we start throwing out things that verbally that we probably shouldn't. And we start inflicting wounds. It's like death by a thousand cuts. He finally acquiesced to what they wanted, and he submitted his resignation, and he left there. And he got he received an opportunity to interview with a church 100+ miles away. And so he interviewed with that church. They wanted him to come preach for them in view of a call. They wanted him to come for the weekend, so they were going to put his wife and he up in a hotel and on Friday night, and he was going to meet with the deacons and the church council and the leadership basically of the church so that they could have a nice meal and some discussion. And then Saturday he'd be able to look around the church community, and then Saturday night it was a drop-in for the whole church to come and meet the potential new pastor and his wife. When he got there, he and his wife walked into the fellowship hall. And it may not have been the first person he encountered, but the first face that he locked on to when he got into that fellowship hall was the man from his previous church who had led the charge to dismiss him. Now, what do you think that guy was there for? To tell them what a great pastor he was? But this guy felt like he had been so damaged by the pastor that now it was his turn to go and ruin his opportunities. Listen, I would not only say that man was disqualified to be a deacon, I would question or not whether he even knows the Lord Jesus Christ. But he was playing the blame game. You hurt me, and I'm going to get even because of what you did to me. So we got the blame game, we got the lame game, which is the self-pity, and then what I call the gastric game, okay? G-A-S-T-R-I-C. Do you know what gastric refers to? It's the gut. This is the stoic person, and you know, sometimes these things overlap. This is a stoic person who will simply hold his feelings in, maybe play the martyr for folks who will listen. Don't talk about it, don't confront it, just pack it away, and maybe at some point down the road we'll unpack it and see what happens. Chuck Swindoll calls this kind of behavior the Scarlett O'Hara syndrome. He says, "I'll think about that tomorrow." But here's what it is. That's like taking a boiling pot and just moving it to a back burner over a low heat. It'll calm down for a while, but sooner or later it will begin to bubble up and boil over again. And, you know, I call it the gastric game because this kind of reaction to mistreatment will affect you physically. And often in the digestive tract, you know? About 35 years ago, I was diagnosed with ulcerative colitis. I don't know how many of you are familiar with what's called UC typically, but it's very painful and it can be very debilitating. And a lot of times people that don't suffer with it, they think it's in your head. But trust me, when you have a flare-up of UC and you know where you spend most of your time and what's going on, yeah, my wife will tell you there was a point when I was in the last church that I pastored that my mother had to come keep the children, but she and my mother had to help me to the car. She literally thought I was going to die because I was losing so much blood. It was a terrible thing. And, you know, one of the things they told me was, we're going to put you on this med because we're trying to avoid surgery. That may have been at a point where I didn't have any insurance. We're trying to avoid surgery. We're going to put you on this medication, and it's going to be a lifetime. You know, something new comes along, we may change it, but you're going to be on medication the rest of your life. This is why I have so many colonoscopies. You know, this last time I got released for 2 years. Woohoo! I started when you drank a gallon of stuff that was not flavored, and can I get a witness? Yeah, there we go. All right. I said, well, what about diet? Well, you know, with the ulcerative colitis, they basically tell you, you eat pretty much what you can tolerate, but make sure you get plenty of fiber. And oh, by the way, you need to control your stress. Yay! Thank you for that, Doc. I'm pastor of church. A lot of people just throw that out there like it's just something that you can snap your fingers and say, okay, I'm not going to be stressed anymore. But the fact of the matter is, what the doctor was saying, listen, what you're going through is a true physical condition. But the more stress you find yourself under, if you can't tolerate it well, it's going to put those gastric juices into overtime, and it's going to cause you to suffer. That's why I call it the gastric game. We just pack it away and hold it down no matter how it affects us. And here's what will happen to you emotionally if you do this. It'll result in cynicism. It'll result in suspicion, and it'll result in doubt. You won't trust anyone. Now, any of you known all three of those kinds of people? Any of you been one of those three kinds of people? I didn't expect to see any hands on that one. Anyway. Now, if those are bad reactions to being mistreated, what should a genuine disciple of the Lord Jesus do differently? Peter offers some pretty good instructions in the text that Mel read just a little while ago in verses 11 through 25 of 1 Peter chapter 2. And in those instructions, he gives us instruction about just about every person who could ever possibly do a wrong to us. So let's take a look at it, okay? This is what it says. First of all, he tells us we need to be good citizens. Obviously, Peter knew that even for his readers in the future, there would probably be governmental systems that they did not like. We've all been there, right? We've had presidents that we liked, presidents that we didn't like. We've had Congress. No, we've never had a Congress that we liked. I think everybody's always hated Congress. That's kind of understandable since they've basically made themselves some kind of fraternity sorority where you have to almost be the child of a former member to get in. And anyway, you didn't come to hear about that. Let's go to something else. Be good citizens. Look at verses 13 and 14 and 17. Submit to every human authority because of the Lord. See that? Remember, when you're reading Scripture to learn, you need to read it slowly. When you're reading Scripture because you want God to speak to you, you don't need to hurry through it. You need to read it slowly. Why should we submit to every human authority? Because of the Lord. Whether it's to the emperor as the ultimate authority, he's talking about earthly, or to governors, those sent out by him to punish those who do what is evil and to praise those who do what is good. And then down in verse 17, at the end of the verse, it says, honor the emperor. Okay? Now, there are other verses where it talks about this. Romans chapter 13, verse 1, starts off by telling us submit to the authorities. But then he goes on to say that there is not a single authority that's in power anywhere that God has not permitted to be there. So when we rebel against the government, we rebel against God. Unless the government sets itself up as an idol, as God. Okay? So we are to submit to civil authorities as long as it does not compromise our biblical values and our citizenship in heaven. Now that's the basic mark of a true disciple. The idea is a voluntary submission to the government that does not attempt to put itself into God's place. Again, verse 13, chapter 13 of Romans, verse 1. This is what Paul said. There is no authority except from God, and those that exist have been instituted by God. Why is Putin in power in Russia? Because God permits it. Why is whoever his name is in power in China? Because God permits it. Why was President Obama president for 8 years? Because God permitted it. Henry McMaster, the governor? Because God permitted it. Yeah, we need to vote. But the fact of the matter is, God ultimately is the controller of all this. Throughout the scriptures, and you really have to get into the Old Testament to understand this, but throughout the scriptures, there have been those amazing, godly people who have served God faithfully while submitting to a pagan government. Joseph, in the book of Genesis, became the second in command of the Egyptian culture. He was a God-fearer, a Jew. Served faithfully. Ezra in the book of Ezra. Nehemiah in the book of Nehemiah. Serving Artaxerxes, the king of the Persians, who built himself as the God king, the ultimate authority. But see, God even moved on Artaxerxes, Darius. Was that Darius? Artaxerxes, anyway, God moved on him to send Nehemiah back to build the walls of the city and to provide all of the resources necessary from the king's treasury to do it. I'm telling you that because I want you to understand that no matter how chaotic things seem, God still has control. There was Esther, who submitted to a foreign king, a pagan king, but saved the lives of her people. There was Daniel, who rose to become one of the primary advisors to a pagan king. I tell you what, he was such a narcissist that when people came in and said, people that hated Daniel, people that wanted to see Daniel gone, they knew that he came out on his balcony at his house every day, three times a day, to offer prayer to God. And by the way, the posture of prayer in the Old Testament was to stand with hands lifted to God. So he'd go out and do that, and they hated him because he was a foreigner. And so they go to the king and they say, you really ought to make a rule that says for the next 30 days or so, nobody can pray to any God except you, O king. And he thought, that's a pretty good idea. And they knew as soon as that happened that they had something on Daniel. So he ends up in a lion's den. And the king was so upset about being used like that. But he had to keep the law, and so Daniel goes in the lion's den. God rescues him from that. The king comes in the morning and says, Daniel, my friend, is the God you served Is the God you serve able to protect you from the lions? And Daniel responded to him, hey, God just shut their mouths because he wanted them extra hungry, because when they pulled Daniel out of the lion's den, he took Daniel's accusers and threw him in. And the lions were not closed-mouthed at that point. They were pretty ravenous. Anyway, yeah, serving a foreign king. Isaiah was the same way. You know, these are people that lived and worked under governments that were not godly, cultures that were not godly, but they were godly. And God honored their faith and protected them and provided for their needs. You know? By the way, everybody wonders about this thing where some of the religious folks came to Jesus and said, is it right for us to pay taxes to the government? Because they lived under Roman domination, right? Jesus wouldn't answer their question the way they wanted it, because they thought, if he says, yes, you need to pay taxes, then they could go to the people and say, what kind of Messiah wants you to pay taxes to a godless government? And if he said, we don't want to pay taxes, then they'd go to Rome and tell Caesar, this man is doing, he is pushing sedition, because he's telling people not to pay taxes. Jesus says to them, does anybody have a coin? And so somebody handed him what's called a denarius. And on that coin was the head, the image of Caesar Tiberius. And imprinted on the coin were the words, Tiberius, son of Augustus, the divine king. Okay. Now, there was one thing that Christians, disciples in the first century, could not say, but it was required by most citizens of the Roman Empire, and that was to say, Caesar is Lord. Christians said, Jesus is Lord. Jesus looks at that coin and he says to them, render unto Caesar, or give to Caesar what belongs to Caesar, and give to God what belongs to God. You pay taxes because you live under Caesar's government. You live under his protection. He provides the police. He provides the military. You know, so he kind of keeps the culture in check. So you pay, but you do not call him Lord. You do not call him divine, because that title only belongs to the Lord Jesus. So, anyway, if the government exists, it does so within the will of God and is designed to promote and exercise law and order within a society. We don't always have to agree with the policies or the practices of the government, but we are admonished in the Word of God to respect the government that does not set itself up as God. So there's the first one. And that's important today because there, you know, the government offends a lot of people. But according to the Word of God, we have a responsibility to be submissive, to be subject. And like I've told you before, if you're posting on Facebook is more often about what's going on in politics than it is about what God is doing in your life or about the Lord Jesus, you need to kind of step back away from Facebook and start thinking about that, praying about it. Because it not only presents you in a negative light as a disciple, but it presents all of us in a negative light. All right, the second thing he says is respect everyone. Look at what it says in verse 17, I think it is. Honor everyone. Now, that pretty much covers all of us, right? That pretty much covers everybody out there, too, right? That covers the persons that are black, white, yellow, red, brown, and various shades, male and female, and any other thing that they can come up with over the next few years. heterosexual, homosexual, bisexual, intersexual, metrosexual, who knows what sexual. But whoever they are, you show them honor. Yeah, and I know this is, see, this is why I told you that you're going to be hanging on to the corner saying, "Is you got anybody up there got any better ideas?" No, they don't. A Christian disciple's ethic must be all-inclusive. All-inclusive. Because all persons are created in the image of God, and all persons are people for whom the Lord Jesus Christ died and rose again. Those things, if no other reason, make everyone that we encounter every day deserving of respect and honor. And see what happens. We get up in the morning, we're in a hurry, we throw on our clothes, we drink our cup of coffee or whatever, or six cups of coffee, whatever it is. We grab our monster drink or whatever. We don't have really that much time to do any Bible reading or prayer. And so we're just saying, "God, give me a good day. God, give me a good day. God, give me a good day." And the next thing we know, the first person we run into is the woman that was driving her husband to church this morning that I got behind trying to come out here. And she was not going to make that left turn from the stop sign until she could absolutely see no traffic coming from either direction. And then when we got to the stoplight, she could have turned right on red, but she wouldn't do it. And I'm sitting behind her thinking, I thought I was going to be on time. Lord, help me, because I was listening to the song on the radio, "There is power in the name of Jesus." And so I sat there at the stoplight saying, "Jesus, Jesus, help me." Literally, because I did not want to be angry with this person in front of me who was just minding her own business. Yeah? She's worthy of honor and respect. But too often, we get into those kinds of hurried situations. We just see people through fleshly eyes. And when we look at people through fleshly eyes, we only see what they are and what they've done. And most of the time, we don't know why they've done what they've done. We don't know why they are like they are. We just see it, and for whatever reason, we're uncomfortable with it or we don't like it. So what we have to do is pray daily before we ever get out of our houses that God would help us to see others through His eyes. You know, He sees what we see, but He also sees what they can be. That's why He loved Peter like He did. He sees what we see, but He also knows the hurt and the baggage and the mistreatment in their lives that have made them what they are, and He still loves them. And if we're going to be His children, if we're going to be His disciples, we have to be the same way. In fact, we have to remember back and think what we used to be, what we used to do. You know, I read this to you last week. There's this passage to the Corinthian church where Paul talks about these God-haters and these adulterers and these thieves and these cheats and these liars and homosexuals and all those things. And he says to them, "Some of you were like this. But then you were washed and you were regenerated You were born again. We need not let the memory of what we were like before we came to Christ become so dark that we feel like we can look at others and say, "You disgust me." We're going to be His children. We can't do anything different but love the people that He loves. All right, here's number three. Love fellow followers. Could have put fellow disciples. That's where He says in verse 17, love the brothers and sisters. This really refers to life within the church, and that's both the global church and the local church, like Nova. The verb form of love here is a present active indicative verb. Now you're saying, so? I'm telling you that because I want you to understand that the best possible translation of this verb is not just to love your fellow followers, to keep on loving their fellow followers, to keep on loving the brothers and sisters. And this is agapao. This is the love that God so often is described as having. Spontaneous and unmotivated and expecting nothing really in return. So when fellow disciples hurt you, knowingly or unknowingly, you know, there are times that I've offended people I didn't even know it. They just quit coming. You know, they don't say anything. So fellow disciples hurt you, if you're going to be a faithful disciple, you know, if they ignore you, if they fall into sin, if they otherwise disappoint you in any way, you know what you do? You love them anyway. Because we are just like your biological family. No matter what you do, you can't make your brother not be your brother anymore. You can't make your sister not be your sister anymore. You can choose not to speak to them or to see them or have any interaction with them, but they are still going to be your blood. And guess what? You can run away. You can stay away. You can bear a grudge. You can nurse bitterness. And you can do all those kinds of things, but it's not going to change the fact that these people are your brothers and sisters. And guess what? On the day of His visitation, when Jesus comes again and there's this great judgment seat of Christ, guess who's going to stand before Him and give an account for not following the biblical method for dealing with conflict? That's going to give an account for nursing the grudge. It's going to be you. Love through the bad stuff if you're a follower of Christ and you're harmed by other disciples. And then the last thing, always honor God. Always honor God. No matter what else is going on in your life, you have to ask the question, how does this honor God? Some translations say fear there, but it's not a terror of God in light of punishment or anything like that. It's just a reverence that's motivated by love, loyalty, and respect. So every day in our lives, our greatest priority should be when I'm talking or when I'm acting, how does what I say and what I do honor God? You got it? You got it now? Government? Submit. Everybody out there that we don't know and who's not like us and maybe doesn't like us and maybe would take something from us if they had the chance, what? Show them respect anyway. Yeah. I'm not going back to that church because there's a couple people I don't like. Huh? They're fellow disciples. You love them as God does. And in everything you do and say, your first priority is honoring God. At work, at play, at home, wherever you are, honoring God. Now, two realities that every real disciple must embrace, okay? This is why He talks about slavery. Because they lived in a culture where almost everybody's slaves. 600,000 slaves, 60 million slaves in the Roman Empire during Peter's day. And they could be, it could be menial slaves that were doing menial tasks, or it could be things like doctors and artists and people like that who just offered themselves in servitude to somebody else. But here's what happened with slaves. Slaves were not allowed to marry. They cohabitated, but if they had children, the children belonged to their slave masters. They could be loved and trusted, but they were absolutely responsible for doing anything and everything that their master told them to do. You know, Peter's here tells them, listen, if you really want to be godly, if you really want to be the disciple that God called you to be, then you've got to bear up and endure under the cruel taskmasters, the cruel masters, as well as those that are good to you. You can't be different in the way you treat them. If you have a good master, then be thankful to God for that. If you have a bad master, then you have to show the same kind of patience and tolerance and endurance while you're serving the bad master. Here are the two things. The first is, every one of us as a disciple is going to experience unjust suffering at some point. Look at verse 21, I believe it is. What does he say there? You were called to this. Isn't that amazing? No one can come to Jesus except the Father draws him. That's the call of God, to be a disciple. When you come to Jesus, he's saying, listen, you're called to suffer. And people say, wait a minute, nobody ever told me that. I didn't sign up for that. What do you mean we're called to suffer? Look at what he says. Because Christ also suffered for you, leaving you an example that you should follow in his steps. I want you to think about it. Pilate says to Jesus, don't you know that I have the power of your life or death in my hands? And Jesus just looks at him and says, you don't have any power except that which is given you from above. What's he saying there? You are the government authority. You have power, but it's only given to you by my Father. So I'm submissive to that. At that point, Jesus could have said, kill this man. Some angel may have struck him dead right there. He didn't. When the first strap laid across his back, when the crown of thorns was pressed upon his head, when the first nail was driven in his hands and wrist, at any of those moments, he could have said, I'm done with this. Kill these people. And they would have all been dead. But God had a purpose for his suffering. The Father had a purpose for his suffering. The Father had a purpose for his death. The Father had a purpose for his resurrection. And he was submissive to them because he was submissive to God. He abandoned his life into the hands of the Father and trusted him completely. That's why he is always our example, and that's the last thing. The Lord Jesus is always our example. Look at verses 22 through 24. He did not commit sin, no deceit found in his mouth. When he was insulted, he did not insult in return. When he did not threaten, but entrusted himself to the one who judges justly, he bore our sins in his body on the tree, so that having died to sins, we might live for righteousness. By his wounds, you have been healed. A lot of people take that verse, those words there, to talk about physical healing, but this is not about physical healing. This is about the healing of the soul, the bringing together of a relationship with God the Father that's been broken for millennia because of sin. So as disciples, according to verse 18, we must be submissive to God's will, focused toward Him, even when our circumstances seem unfair and unjust and heartbreaking. And the reason for that is because it pleases God. It says it endures, it engenders favor for us. That's mercy. That's grace. And so you're asking why. Why should I do this? You don't know what people have done to me. You don't know what I've lost. You don't know what I could have been or could have had. Look at verse 25. Because it ends by just reminding us that we, like sheep, have gone astray, but we've been drawn back. That's why we're disciples. And the reason we should be submissive is because the Lord Jesus Himself is our shepherd and our protector. I know that word is translated in some places as overseer there. What it actually says in the Greek, the first definition is the guardian. He is the shepherd and the guardian of your souls. You know, if you are attempting to follow the Lord Jesus with all your heart, soul, mind, and strength, nothing is going to happen to you without His permission. Nothing. So here's what I'm asking you to do. When you're relating to other people out there, show them respect. You know, the golden rule still applies. We just don't use it very much. Jesus said, don't do unto others as they do unto you. Do unto others as you wish they would do to you. Within the church family, let love always be unmotivated and undemanding. Because Jesus said, by this one thing, all men will know that you're my disciples, that you love one another. Who do you need to make amends to in the church family? In your relationship to God through the Lord Jesus Christ, honor Him as Lord of your life every day, and the result will be that you will have the most abundant, meaningful, fruitful life possible. And in your citizenship, be submissive and respectful. Obey the laws, be respectful of the leaders, as long as it doesn't require you to compromise your faith. When the government begins to move in a direction that is anti-God, take your stand and do it respectfully. Let's pray together. Let me ask you a couple of questions. Are you holding grudges or nursing bitterness today because of a wrong that you've suffered? If so, it's time for you to let go and forgive and trust Jesus for justice. Do you pray for our national, state, and local leaders more than you complain or criticize? How about your boss? How about your church leadership? You commit yourself today that every time you feel the need to complain or criticize leadership, that you would stop and pray for them. Do you show proper respect to everyone regardless of race, culture, sexual orientation, political affiliation, religious preference? You know you should. You can shout out all you want. Isn't there someone else with a better idea? But there's not. This is what God wants you to be and do. And then this final question, how well do you represent your Heavenly Father when you're out there in the world? None of us is perfect. We all are going to have failures. We're all going to fall at times. But the question is that your goal? Is that what you're pursuing? To honor God in your life in every way. Lord Jesus, you've spoken to us through the great apostle Peter. You told us what you expect of us as we live a disciple life. So for those to whom you've spoken about actions they should take today, may they be quick to trust you and obey. God bless us and help us to represent you well out there in the world, and protect us over this holiday weekend. And use us for your glory wherever we find ourselves. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Thank you so much for your attention. Nova Nation Band.
Oh God, you are my God.